My name is Fumi Urano, from the Washington University School of Medicine in the United States. I'd like to, thank everyone who came to this meeting, and I'd like to thank, Paul, Tracy, Michael, Alan, Lisa, and everyone, who have been organizing this important meetings. So today I'd like to update the U.S. clinical trials. As everyone knows, right now World Cup rugby is ongoing, and the England team is, has a very good chance to win the World Cup, led by Eddie Jones, who used to be a Japan's head coach. Right now, Japan is playing against Ireland, so I will find out the results soon. Okay, so I'd like to thank everyone, Dr. Barrett, and Dr. Halsey, Dr. Marshall, who are here, and Stephanie from Snow Foundation is not here. I always appreciate the support from Wolfram UK, and today Federica from Wolfram Italy is here too. So this is this picture was taken 5 years ago. Everyone except Daniel is here. So this is my third or fourth time. So before I go into the clinical trial, I just want to show one slide about Wolfram syndrome, because we talked about via genetic testing of Wolfram syndrome last night. So as you know, Wolfram syndrome is an autosomal recessive genetic disorder characterized by diabetes mellitus, diabetes insipidus, optic nerve atrophy, hearing loss, and the neuronal degeneration. But there are two other groups of patients, who have Wolfram gene mutations, but these patients develop only, sometimes they only develop diabetes, sometimes they only develop hearing loss, sometimes they only develop optic nerve atrophy and hearing loss, and some patients just develop cataracts. And there's another group of people who develop very severe form of disease, and they develop neonatal diabetes, congenital cataracts, sensory neural deafness, and they are floppy babies, so they have severe hypotonia. So there is a way to distinguish these three groups of people, so if you have any questions, just let me know later on. But today I'm going to focus on this group of patients. And so this, I have been using this slide for in the past 7 years. So to achieve a cure for Wolfram syndrome, we have three steps. The first step is to protect and regrow, stop the progression of the disease. Second step is to protect and regrow remaining tissues. And the third step is to replace pathogenic genes and damaged tissues. So today I'm going to focus on to stop the progression of the disease using medicine, so pills. And this is a very simplified scientific slide, pathogenesis of the Wolfram. So as you know, the root cause of the disease is the mutations in the WFS1 gene that can lead to the endoplasmic reticulum calcium medications. Endoplasmic reticulum is a cellular compartment executing many important biological functions, and that can lead to cell stress called endoplasmic reticulum stress, and then that can lead to clinical, downstream clinical manifestations. So we want to target the upstream to stop the progression of the disease, and clearly the very upstream is the Wolfram gene mutations. So eventually we have to use deep gene therapy, and we are working very hard on this. But right now we are trying to target the little downstream endoplasmic reticulum using small molecules, pills. And so we did a compound screen to identify currently available drugs for the treatment of Wolfram, and we identified 7-8 candidates. This was done by my former student, Dr. Liu. Now she works for a biotech company in Shanghai, China. Wuzi Biologics, that's one of the biggest biotech companies in China. So this is a drug we identified, dantrolene sodium. It is approved by FDA, US FDA, for the treatment of two different conditions. This molecule targets some receptor localized to the endoplasmic reticulum. And so it is currently approved for the treatment of spasticity, muscle stiffness. And it's neurologists don't use this drug anymore for spasticity because there are many other good drugs now, but this is approved for the treatment of spasticity. And also, this is approved for the treatment of malignant hyperthermia. This is IV form. So, malignant hyperthermia is a medical condition that can happen during the anesthesia. And so people are very sensitive to anesthesia. Muscle contracts too much, creates too much heat. And so to prevent that, this drug is utilized. So interestingly, this drug could be beneficial for patients with Wolfram syndrome because this targets the endoplasmic reticulum. So we did so-called preclinical studies using cells from patients and animal models of Wolfram syndrome. And so this is what happened between 2016 to 2018. The drug was approved as for the orphan drug designation for the treatment of Wolfram by US FDA. And we got the investigational new drug status for the treatment of Wolfram syndrome in 2017. We got the equivalent status from EMA in 2017. The trial in the US started in January 2017, and it's ongoing but almost ending. So this is the study design, and this study was designed based on the data acquired at the Wolfram Syndrome Research Clinic at Washington University, led by Dr. Hersey and Dr. Marshall. But this is the design. So in the first five visits, so clearly there's the screening. Then in the first five visits, we gradually increase the dose of the drug, gradually increase the dose of the drug. And then at 6 months, we looked at the efficacy of the drug. So we looked at visual acuity. We chose three things: visual acuity, remaining beta cell function, it's called boost test. And we also looked at neurological functions and the quality of life measures based on the disease rating scale developed by Dr. Hersey's group. So then some people kept on taking the drug up to 12, 18, and 24 months. So this is the patient flow of the study. So 22 subjects with Wolfram syndrome screened. Most of them have been participating in the research clinic. And one subject was not eligible because of some medical reason. And the 20 subjects started treatment, but two subjects excluded because they wanted to start a family. So, to get pregnant, they had to stop taking the drug. So two subjects excluded, and indeed actually male subjects, but still the same thing. And 19 people completed 6 months dantrolene sodium. I'm gonna show the data. And the 16 subjects opted into extension phase of dantrolene sodium. That means they kept on taking the drug up to 12, 18, and 24. So I didn't have time to analyze the 24 months time point, but I will show the data up to 18 months time point. And this is the demographic and clinical characteristics of the subjects. So FDA approved to recruit both pediatric and adult populations because Wolfram syndrome starts at pediatric population, and they agreed that we should start, we should treat patients earlier. So we could include pediatric population. So 8 pediatric patients and 11 pediatric patients, 11 adult patients. And, so as they have diabetes, optic nerve atrophy, diabetes mellitus. And here are the adverse events, side effects. So the two major side effects. So we classified side effects into three groups. So one is dantrolene related, so these are known side effects. Second one is wolfram related, so these are the symptoms often seen in patients with Wolfram syndrome. And third one is non-specific, so we don't know what it is. Now we just go through briefly. So fatigue and diarrhea, the two major side effects. So many patients say, you know, I feel more tired or I have diarrhea. So we had to reduce the dose. And so hypoglycemia and headaches, we also often saw, you know, you can see 1/3 of people experience hypoglycemia and headaches and hyponatremia for patients. And there are non-specific, you know, influenza, rhinovirus infection, knee infection, hit by car, I think this is because of the vision. But you know, these are non-specific side effects. I would say adverse events, I shouldn't say side effects. Adverse events. So fatigue and diarrhea are the two major side effects. So by reducing the dose, these side effects resolved. So here is, so this is how we titrated out the dose. So, you know, we gradually increase the dose, then eventually we decrease the dose around 2.5 milligram per kilogram per day for kids in between this. And in adults, this is, yeah, you know, in between 50 milligram to 100 milligram per day. So usually dantrolene pill, 25 milligram per pill, this means two pills in the morning, two pills at night. Or one pill in the morning, one pill at night. That's the dose. But most patients took this. And so, okay, so this is my group. You know, everyone is so great. And so here are the, you know, more like efficacy results. So this is the result of mixed meal stimulated C-peptide test. Means patients, you know, get fasted, then we give their, you know, sweet drink. It contains a lot of carbohydrate, you know, and a protein. And so then after 30 minutes, we took the blood and we looked at the levels of C-peptide. C-peptide is the insulin produced in your pancreas. So it's chemically, structurally different from, you know, artificial insulin you are taking. So this is a way to look at remaining pancreas, you know, functions. So visit screening is before the treatment. So this is the number before the treatment. And after 6 months, we saw some increase. This may not be clinically significant, but this is statistically significant. So we saw some increase in C-peptide levels after 6 months treatment of dantrolene sodium. So we kept on looking at the effect of dantrolene sodium on C-peptide levels. So this is after this is before the treatment. After 6 months, after 12, and after 18, this is what we found. So mild increase in C-peptide levels. And this is visual acuity. So the Snellenchamp score was converted into Longmuir score based on the, you know, studies done by Dr. Hussey. And so this is Longmuir score before the treatment and after the treatment, exactly the same. And you know, based on Dr. Hussey's study, I believe she's going to show, but you know, the visual acuity does not change much, right, over 2 years. We have to look at least over 2 years. So this is what we saw, and you know, this is 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, basically no change, statistically no change. And this is Wolfram Unified Rating Scale. This was developed by also, you know, Dr. Hassi's team. So this is rating. Every time we find a, just to simplify, every time we find an issue, you get 1 point. So if you have a lot of problems, you get, you know, higher number. If you have less problems, you get lower number. It's a disease rating scale. So before the treatment, it was 22, average 18, and visit 10, 15. And we tend to see trend for decrease in of the disease rating scale number in pediatric population. This is pediatric population before the treatment 21 and 18 to 12. In adults, basically we don't see any change. So here is the summary of our findings. So trial findings, safe dose for pediatric population is 0.5 milligram kilogram per day up to 2 milligram per kilogram per day. In adults, in between 50 milligram per day, 200 milligram per day. So that basically either 2 pills in the morning, 2 pills at night, or 1 pill in the morning, 1 pill at night. And dantrolene may improve beta cell function, and dantrolene may improve disease rating scale. The reason I say may is that there are limitations in this study. This is an uncontrolled study, so that means all the patients took the drug. So we did not include the placebo group. We did not include the group that did not take the real drug. So everybody took the drug, so we cannot exclude placebo effect. And the future direction could be, so I think, I believe there are two options for future. So we may want to randomize placebo-controlled double-blind study, just like Dr. Barrett has been doing in the UK. That would be the best always. And or a new trial with second-generation dantrolene sodium and ER stress reducer. So second-generation dantrolene sodium, better version of dantrolene sodium is actually available now. So we are working on that drug. And Dr. Hassi and Dr. Marshall, is in the group for the NIH grant. And we are also developing endoplasmic reticulum stress reducer called AMX0035. You can Google it together with a biotech company in the US, Cambridge, United States, not Cambridge in UK. So this is the summary. So we are targeting endoplasmic reticulum calcium leakage right now, but we want to target more upstream in the future, so these are ongoing. And so we also have just set up the genetic testing for Wolfram and WFSM related disorder. So we used to call two different groups of people as Wolfram-like patients, but we don't call them Wolfram-like patients anymore. We call them WFSM related disorder. So if you're interested, just take a look. And here is, so there is a lot of reasons to be optimistic because many drugs have been developed by Dr. Barrett's group and the group in Europe. And so we are working very hard at Washington University, together with Dr. Marshall and Dr. Rossi, and Dr. Barrett is always helpful. And so I'd like to thank my family, my wife, my twin boys, Thomas and Craig, and Biscuit is my dog. Thank you.